Hey, good morning, eighth grade. How are we doing? We are going to talk a little bit about colonial governments today. So I hope you're feeling good. We're going to have this discussion, though, about how and the types of governments they have. And we are going to kind of talk about how they work a little bit today. That's going to be kind of the focus of the lecture today. And I'm probably going to assign an ed puzzle to this a little bit later. So we will see how that goes. Wish me luck. All right, there's a good one I found, which I found really entertaining, so I hope you enjoy that. It will be a separate video from this one. So watch this first, then watch the Ed puzzle. It's a fellow teacher I had. She made a really good one, and I just want you guys to watch that one because it's really stinking good. So I thought you guys would enjoy it. That being said, let's talk a little bit about these colonial governments. When we look at colonial governments, I want you to understand that there are three types of governments that existed under England. And like I said, the other video is going to kind of go into the history of Magna Carta and kind of where our ideas for these governments come from and how all of that relates to American history and how it relates, frankly, to American government. But these are kind of the first types of governments that we're going to have a discussion about. All right. Now, quick review. We have the British have started a couple of colonies. The first one didn't work out so well. Roanoke failed. Jamestown has been blisteringly tough, but it's starting to work out. Plymouth also started off really tough, but with the help of the Wampanoag Indians, they were able to succeed. All right. And so these two colonies are going to be the start, if you will. This is kind of what we look at as the beginning of American history, Jamestown and Plymouth. That's really where we're at. There are similarities and differences. We talked a little bit about this the other day. The amount of kids people brought to Plymouth up here, over 30%. They brought their families. Whereas Jamestown, people didn't really bring their kids. They came down here seeking fame, fortune, those types of things. And so that's one of the little differences. But the thing they have in common, excuse me, is that they have come here. They're both going to be British, and they're going to start British and democratic traditions here in what will eventually become the United States. All right. So, like I said, there's three types of colonies. If you were going to start a colony, you needed to get permission from the king. The King of England had a lot of power, and one of the things that you had to do was get his permission in order to start these colonies. So you had a lot of wheeling and dealing and a lot of, hey, if you let me do this, we'll get you that type of deals going on. So your first colonies were called proprietary colonies. These were created with large land grants from the king, and authority was typically given to one man or a small group of men. Case in point, you could look at Massachusetts Bay Colony, Plymouth, as being a proprietary colony because a small group of people came there, and then they were given kind of dominion over that territory. The next type of colony was a royal colony. And I've mentioned this before. Royal colonies were created by a grant of authority under the king's approval to a group, and this was also subject to the laws of England. So a royal colony had a lot more protections under the English, where a proprietary colony might be allowed to do more of its own thing. The third type of colony was a corporate or a charter colony. Now, this was created with both Parliament and the king and whatever group was creating this. This is typically what you would have think of, like this is how Jamestown starts. But if you remember, things get rough in Jamestown. So Jamestown starts as a corporate colony, but then later turns into a royal colony because of that Anglo-Powhatan War, if you remember. Things couldn't get handled, so the British ended up taking over. So that's your three groups for colonies. Those are your three levels of colony. Again, a lot of colony freedoms here. You can kind of make your own rules as long as you're swearing loyalty to the king. Corporate colonies were seen as businesses. Businesses made their own rules. And then royal colonies, again, kind of were subject to the laws of England and whatnot. So that's kind of the difference. But again, a lot of freedom up here, a lot of freedom down here. So if you had a proprietary or a corporate colony, you could kind of set it up however you wanted, kind of make your own little dream colony, if you will. Charters could be given and take away. And the reason for that is people, for a while might be real popular. Maybe the king really likes you. Maybe the king dies. Maybe there's a new king and the new king doesn't like you. They can take that charter away and then claim that that is the dominion of the king. So you really had to do a lot of butt kissing to keep your charter or your proprietary charters with the king. Otherwise, they would just lay the hammer down and make it a royal colony. So you had three groups of colonies here. There were the New England colonies. Again, we start off here. Here's Plymouth. Up here's where eventually will become Boston. This was originally, if you look at this map, all of this used to be Massachusetts Bay Colony. But you're going to see that there's other colonies that get started. And that's because our Puritan friends, well, they're a little hard to live with after a while. And then you have the middle colonies. New York was started by the Dutch. You know that it was originally called New Amsterdam. And then they will start to create other colonies, New Jersey, Delaware, Pennsylvania. And again, they're kind of arguing up here with these guys. But these are what we considered middle colonies. And these are going to come later, if you will. And then there's your southern colonies. Your southern colonies, you know, for case in point, were our first colonies. Jamestown was over here. Now you've moved up to Williamsburg, but that's Virginia. You have Maryland, you have North, South Carolina, and Georgia. And we'll talk about how all these colonies get formed and who starts them and whatnot at a later time. So governors, though. Governors were usually the leader of the colonies. Now, again, remember, a governor is much different back then than it is today. A governor was appointed by the king. Usually it's one of the king's buddies. Maybe it's somebody who created the charter with them. But basically, they're not elected. Okay, that's what I want you to understand. You didn't vote for your governor like we do nowadays. The governor was chosen by the king. And again, the governor was usually there at the whim of the king. The king could recall the governor at any time. And so they, again, really wanted to chew. The governor was kind of seen as a stepping stone to move up in the court of the king. All right. The governors, though, have a lot of power. They're kind of like the kings of the colony. Nothing can pass in their legislation without the governor's approval. You might say 99% of all the people like something. And if the other governor goes and looks at it and goes, no, it ain't going to happen. So, again, there's no, you know, it's a kind of like his own, you know, he's representing the king. He is the king's representative. That is what the governor's job is. The governor, though, also commanded the militia. They could also choose and appoint all the judges, and they could order actions to the Navy or Army in the colony. Even they could order their legislature to dissolve. Like I said, if something was really popular and the governor doesn't seem to be getting along with the local legislature, the governor could just say, hey, we're going to make a new one that's dissolved and hold new elections. He could do that anytime. And governors were always men as chosen by the king back then due to traditions. Legislatures. Now, I've talked to you a little bit about legislatures before. I talked to you a little bit about the House of Burgesses and whatnot. The legislature was typically made into two parts. Now, if you're looking at political science and you're studying politics, we call that bicameral. That means two houses. Today, when something's bicameral, we say Congress is bicameral. We have a House of Representatives and a Senate, two houses. But they both make laws, and then they both have to come to an agreement on how that law will pass. There was the council. Members of the council, again, chosen by the king, appointed by the king. They typically served longer than the governors because the council members, even though they're lower than the governor, would report to the king. And let's just say they would report to the king, especially whenever a governor looks bad. The reason why, the council members were trying to move up to become governors. And they were kind of seen as the king's inside guys. And they thought, well, maybe they could maneuver and try to move up the ladder, so to speak. So it's funny, the council members were kind of the watchdogs of the governors. So the governors were always trying to make the council members happy, which in turn they thought made the king happy to keep their job, and then hopefully move them up in the royal court as well. The governor was absent. You had what was called a lieutenant governor, and then the council would be the local government. All right. So again, notice something I'm talking about, though. A lot of the words I'm using are appointed, not by the people, by the king. And that's telling you just how much power the king has with this original colonial setup. Councils also served as the superior court, which means if you had a grievance or if you had an issue, somebody sued you, you sued them, they're going to hear the arguments for and against this. Most of the council members were unpaid. They have other jobs. Typically, they're lawyers or they're merchants. But the job, even though it's not paid, has perks. Again, you have the ear of the king. You have the ear of the governor. So if you're a lawyer or you're a business person, Yeah, you're going to find laws. You're going to create laws that probably help you out more so than maybe the average person. The assembly was known by a lot of different names: the House of Delegates, the House of Burgesses, the Assembly of Freemen. These were the elected officials. All right. Typically, these were your people. They had every year there was an election and you had new people come in. A burgess is just a representative. A delegate is just a representative. Today we call it the House of Representatives. In Illinois, we call it the General Assembly, but again, we call it the House of Representatives. Back then, we had an election every year. Nowadays, if we elect a representative, it's every 2 years. A lot of the elected citizens, though, they'd meet about once a year. Now, those meetings could go on for a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, you know, a month, depending on it. So to say they met once a year wasn't like they met on like some Tuesday and they went, hey, you got anything? No? Okay, I'm going home. So they would meet, and those meetings would typically last for a little bit of time. Their decisions, though, were massively important. They made decisions about taxes. They would talk about the government budgets. All of that would start in the assembly because since they were directly elected by the people, it was kind of based on the parliamentary model. The parliament in England has a bicameral legislature. One part's called the House of Commons. The second part's called the House of Lords. The House of Commons were us. It was the common people. They were elected people. The House of Lords were the royal family and the aristocrats and, you know, the dukes and the barons and the duchesses and, you know, all that sort of. So the House of Lords was not elected. They were representative of the noble families, of the nobility, whereas the House of Commons was more of the common person, you know, like you and I. So this is based on very much what's going on over in Great Britain over there. And so they would have everything. And the reason you had the taxes and the budget start with the House of Commons is they thought if the people felt like they had a say in this, they couldn't be mad if they raised the taxes and said, hey, well, you elected them, vote somebody else in next year. They did have rules. You did have to be a person that owned property. You had to be white, sometimes of British descent, in order for people to vote in the assembly. If you were in Massachusetts Bay Colony, you had to prove that you were a member of the Puritan Church. So there's a whole bunch of other stipulations. So to call this a democracy is true, but it's not how you and I look at democracy today. Today we look at democracy where we allow, you know, women have the right to vote. You don't have to own property to vote. It doesn't matter what your religion is or what creed or color or whatever your skin is. Everybody has the right to vote nowadays. So we have a lot more democratic of a system today. But again, these are the beginnings. We're talking about the beginnings. When things start, does everybody know exactly what they're doing? No, they're kind of feeling it out. And what a lot of these folks are doing, much like the Pilgrims did, they formed that Mayflower Compact. And for all intents and purposes, a lot of these folks make the rules as they go because they don't know what to expect. So I hope that was educational for you. That is going to be our discussion about the types of colonies. I'm going to have a little Ed puzzle here for you today. And like I said, I hope you like my friend's presentation. I thought she did a really good job. It's got a few questions for you. All right. I will see you at the Zoom. Take care, guys. Bye-bye.